Welcome back to The Breakfast. Moving away from today in history, we are now going to be talking about the economy and, of course, comments made by former President Olusegun Obasanjo and Professor Pat Utomi and a few others, saying that the current administration's strategies in fixing our economy, you know, may be wrong. We, of course, will be speaking this morning with Dr. Nnemeka Obiariri, an investment banker, to quickly share his thoughts with us on, you know, on their comments and, you know, what he really feels the current administration is doing right or wrong with regard to our economy. Dr. Nnemeka, thank you. Good morning. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
All right. First question. Do you share similar sentiment or you hold a contrary opinion?
I share similar sentiment 110%.
Why?
Okay. To be honest, my heart bleeds because this country is one country that is a paradise that has been turned into a jungle. And a jungle that can be rehabilitated to become a paradise if we do the right things. Currently, we are teetering on the precipice. And unless we retrace our steps and do the right things, we'll continue to go down the hill. I will give you an example. This government came into power and mounted diversification, and all those stuff. Firstly, they said that they were going to go into agriculture to ensure that we go back to what used to be the mainstay of Nigeria economy between 1960 and 1965, when we ran a very beautiful republic, the First Republic. And of course, that republic was hinged on fiscal responsibility, regional autonomy, resource control, and some of the governance principles that enabled the regions to grow at their own paces. Now, I want to ask us a simple question. A country blessed with 64 million hectares of arable land, 110 million employable adults active and willing to work, but yet the policies and programs are not being in place to engage them. How can we as a nation say we want to go into agriculture, we want to diversify into agriculture, yet the level of insecurity in the land has become so atrocious? In the Northwest, North Central, and Northeast, as we are supposedly the food baskets of Nigeria, farmers can no longer go to their farms unless they bribe bandits. We are all witnesses of about 43 farmers that were beheaded.
Let me quickly jump in here. Some of the things that you've mentioned, unfortunately, of course, have slowed down the moves by the government to fix the economy. Security, for example, and the challenges that we have with it, obviously, of course, is one of the, you know, biggest reasons why our economy might be slow. But the moves that the government has made so far, they, of course, continued. And even recently, the government, the president once again said Nigerians should go back to agriculture. Do you think in any way that their efforts have been in any way fruitful? Unfortunately, of course, the insecurity challenges and COVID-19 and whatnot has maybe slowed it down. Do you think they've put in some effort, but it maybe just hasn't worked out the way we expected?
Let me tell you this. You know, when we talk about government, we pay so much attention to the federal government without looking at the other tiers of government. Yes, agriculture should have been the mainstay, should have been our focus, because it's a low-hanging fruit with low technology. But I want to tell you, there has been a serious disconnect between the monetary policy and the fiscal policy side of this sector. Recently, I'll give you an example. The Central Bank of Nigeria, I must commend Godwin Emefiele, has been at the forefront of providing funding for the agri sector. But the fiscal side, especially the states, have not told along to do what we're supposed to do. The Central Bank of Nigeria, 3 years ago, came up with a plan to revive the palm oil sector. Remember, in 1964, Nigeria controlled 45% of the global palm oil market. We saw crude oil and we abandoned that sector. If we have continued in that trajectory, control that market till now, by now we'll have been exporting over $36 billion worth of crude palm oil.
Dr. Obiariri,
just like Malaysia and Indonesia.
Let me interject, because the more this conversation is progressing, the more I'm thinking, is it a problem of strategy or implementation? Because if you look at it, you said yourself that the government looks to agriculture, but there are challenges with, you know, implementation because of insecurity. Government has also said that they should not be seen as the primary source of investment. We should be looking more to private sector investment. They've come up with, you know, reform programs, which I will be mentioning a few in the course of this conversation. The question remains, is it about strategy or implementation? Because the headline says that the government is adopting the wrong strategy. Let's take it from there first.
We are on the same page. It's one thing to mount policies and programs, it's another thing to pursue it. I'm just trying to illustrate an example of where government has how they failed in this regard. The central bank has provided 32 billion naira as spam intervention fund. And the central bank governor was even gracious enough to invite 11 governors of the South, South, and Southeast. And said, okay, come, let's partner together. Of course, the private sector is supposed to drive it. But you forgot also that the private sector has some level of limitations. We talked about insecurity. What of the issue of the Land Use Act? The only way we can, the strategy is for us to adopt a private-public partnership arrangement. And the public-private partnership arrangement is being hindered because of the fiscal deformities, the inability of the state governors and even the local government chairman to get into this. I want to give you a practical illustration. Nigeria today has a deficit of about 1.4 million metric tons of the palm oil. To cover that gap, we have to cultivate new 400,000 hectares of the tenera or super gene species. The central bank governor met with the local guys, okay, you are the palm belt. Can we provide about 100,000 hectares of land that we can cultivate between 2020 to 2025? But as I talk to you today, call up any of the governors and ask them what private-public partnership frameworks have they put in place to identify palm operators within that sector to drive that industry. And I tell you, if they had adopted, like they say, it's a strategy, we want to do palm, we want to do agriculture. But what programs, what specific public private partnership arrangement are they putting in place to drive it? If the governors had keyed into what Emefiele wanted to do, by now, we will have cultivated at least 50,000 hectares. I will give you an example of all this we do. 50,000 hectares cultivated within that period Emefiele had a meeting with them. By 2024, will have been producing about 1.8 million tons of fresh fruit bunches that will have enabled us to have about 300 cottage industries that will process them, that will have created about 500,000 jobs. But as I talk to you today, there is no one single state in the South, South, and Southeast that have connected with what is being done at the federal level. And do you know why? Because of the fiscal irresponsibility that we have in Nigeria, based on the 1999 Constitution, that have made everybody to depend on the center. People do not care how they can develop their state. Every month, they will gather in Abuja to share money from the good oil revenue that comes in from the Niger Delta. If we had looked at the foundational problem of Nigeria, which is the 1999 Constitution that have centralized everything and have gone back to 1963 Republic Constitution that allowed the regions to grow at their pace, at their different paces, that will allow them to control 50% of their resources, that will discourage the gathering of every month in Abuja to share money. Most of these states will have grabbed what they basically offered and looked inward. The major challenge we have is not strategy. The major challenge we have is we have a constitutional deformity.
All right.
A constitutional lacuna that will not allow us to do the right thing because we have free money that we will share in Abuja every month.
It's of course, one of the sad parts of, you know, our country, you know, like you've said, state governments who have not gotten themselves to be able to think inward on how to generate revenue for themselves or for their states. And of course, like you said, the regular pattern of every month going to Abuja to, you know, get their own share of the revenue that is generated from oil. But let's move away from the state governors. I hope, you know, that we can get to a point where we can address these concerns, as you've mentioned, with regards to the 1999 Constitution. But I want us to look now at our policies on importation, banning of certain goods, our foreign exchange policy also, and how that may also have either helped or, you know, done more damage, you know, to our economy and the strategies to build our economy.
The buying of certain commodities in Nigeria, especially those that require low technology to produce, like toothpicks and all those stuff, this is a very good strategy. But the challenge is when you ban those products, what import substitution program have you put in place to ensure that those products are produced here? I will give you an example. Soya beans oil, which is a very common oil that are used by most manufacturing firms that are into margarine and all those stuff. Most of them imported from China. Soya beans oil, Nigeria is one of the biggest producers of soya beans, can easily be processed in Nigeria. In fact, most of the fabrication machines that are used to process soya beans oil into soya beans oil are produced here, can manufactured in Apa and in Onitsha. Now, the question is, if we have banned these projects, if we have banned these products, what programs have we put in place to ensure that we produce them in Nigeria here to cover that gap? The second one is the issue of, we have been talking about issue of smuggling. The custom DG did something that is very, very commendable. He has sent a proposal to this National Assembly to reduce tariff on imported cars and equipment to 5%. That is very, very commendable. Nigeria is supposed to be the transshipment hub of West Africa. If this is done, most of the things that are smuggled through Togo, through Benin Republic, there will no longer be incentive for them to be shipped to Benin Republic and Togo. They will come through Apapa port. They will come through Port Harcourt port. And it will save us a whole lot of income that we'll have lost pursuing smugglers who diverted goods that should have come to Nigeria into Togo and Benin Republic. And this policy will also help us, because once these things are concentrated in Nigeria, the next thing we should do, how do we create a pathway, a railway that links the coastal countries of West Africa and a good road so that most of these countries will be coming to Nigeria to pick those goods through the Apapa port, through the Port Harcourt port. Remember, there used to be a time traders used to come from Togo, from Benin Republic, from Burkina Faso, from Gabon, from Cameroon, to Apapa and Onitsha to come and buy things. Today, they are no longer coming because of insecurity, because of some of these issues that has to do with closing the borders without thinking deeply about the implications.
Quickly,
if you
also
look at the volume of Nigeria and West African countries, we have surplus trade with them, but closing those borders destroyed loads of businesses in Nigeria that depend on those cross-border trade. It's a good thing that they removed those border closure, that opened the border. And it's a good thing that pursued this kind of policies that we enable Nigeria to become a hub that we're supposed to be.
All right. I understand we have just about 5 minutes left for this conversation. So I want to take your view quickly on federal government structural reforms in response to the economic crisis, which a lot of persons are not happy with. One of them, I would prefer to start with the economic sustainability plan, but let's look at the freshly minted finance bill that is now law. What's your assessment of the impact in trying to, you know, revamp and grow the economy, basically? Of what impact will it be?
To be honest, Nigeria has not been short of, you know, drawing up good policies. The problem has been in implementations. You remember in 2017, April, to be precise, we launched with fanfare the Economic Recovery and Growth Plan. Yeah. And let me tell you, if you pick that one up, one of the things that the federal government said they would do was that between 2017, that they would facilitate the development of about 2 million housing units to reduce the 20 million housing deficit in Nigeria within 3 years. As I'm talking to you, they also stated that they were going to raise about 1 trillion naira National Housing Development Fund under a private-public partnership arrangement. As I talk to you, we are in 2020. Today is the last day in 2020. Please, can you call Mr. Fashola or Mr. President or anybody in the Ministry of Housing and ask them, where are the 20 million housing units that we promised Nigerians with so much fanfare and glitterity in April 2017? We are in 2020, December 31st. I can bet a finger they will not show you 10,000 housing units.
Okay, Dr. Obiari, you've highlighted some of the many challenges that we have. the insecurity that's affecting our economic growth, the pandemic, as it were, that has also impacted negatively on the economy. What are some of the strategies? What are some of the, you know, measures you think that in the coming year the government can begin to put in place to show a will to actually move the economy in the right direction?
Very simple. You cannot talk about controlling insecurity, banditry, and henchmen without, first of all, banning the putting in place an open a ban on open grazing. If you look at what is happening today in Nigeria, most of these terrorists and bandits hide in form of henchmen and all manner of. I've said it clearly. The only way we can salvage security in the southern part of Nigeria is for us to put a ban on open grazing. Nigeria is the only country in the whole wide world that is still steeped in these archaic ways of animal husbandry. We ban it. And then the issue of Okada riding. I've sent a proposal to the Lagos state government. Lagos is sitting on a time bomb. Most of the people that operate Okadas do not have documentations. We don't even know their home addresses. A policy should be put in place to document biometrically every person who is involved in minibus and Okada riding in such a way that we can number them, tag them, provide them with ID card, and put agencies that will ensure that we monitor their movement in clock fast, so that we'll be able to show up security. You cannot show up security in Nigeria or drive agriculture without banning open grazing and putting in place an agro-pastoral arrangement that can enable people to grow at their own paces.
Quickly.
Look at Netherlands.
Quickly.
Netherlands, 70 million people. They export over 120 million dollars of
Mr. Obiari.
The Netherlands,
Mr. Obiari, apologies. I know that you have a lot, you know, that you would love to share. I wanted, you know, you to, in 30 seconds, quickly speak on the economic management team, which has, you know, a lot of very prominent Nigerians. Charles Soludo, former CBN governor, was also one of those people. What do you think, you know, that they might still be able to advise and fix, you know, in the time that they have? In 30 seconds, please.
Obasan just said one thing, which is very apt. It is one thing to advise him. It's another thing for him to listen to your advice. I have no doubt in the abilities of Charles Soludo. If you look at some of his presentations, he has a manuscript, he has a blueprint on how we can transform this country. But the question is, will Buhari and Oshibanjo and co listen to them?
Okay.
All right. That was, you really kept the time. Thank you very much, Dr. Obiariri, for joining us on The Breakfast this morning. Your thoughts and your time is appreciated.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Merry Christmas.
Right. Moving on, we are going next to talk about the National Identity Number, the NIMC, and of course the call from Nigerians that the time should be extended. In what ways, you know, can this be achieved without, you know, going through the hassle that it has caused so far?
Yeah, I was going to interject and say, I was actually going to interject when he was talking about tagging Okada riders, that's motorcycle riders, with getting their IDs and all of that. I think that's one of the reasons why we are having this push to get better data of the people that live in this country with the NIN. So we'll find a way to chip that in with our next guest, hopefully. We'll have them as smoothly as we've had the previous guests this morning. Just stay with us.